Good morning. Yeah, I'll be, skipping some of the slides to conserve the time. And since morning, I had a very fruitful discussion with Professor Shwari, Professor Manke, Tom. So I'll also give you a few slides about the small satellites, and maybe you can make a satellite and ISRO can launch it. You know, launching cost is approximately $30,000 nowadays, $30,000 or so per kg. Okay. That's what cost is there. But ISRO can launch free. There are so many facilities also which ISRO can provide. Almost a dozen institutions are working in the country, education institutions. The students are making the satellite. First satellite was made by Anna University, that is called AnnaSat, to Chennai. The second satellite was made by some eight engineering colleges from Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, and that satellite was launched. It's called StuSat. So both those satellites are working wonderfully. The third satellite will launch in September, along with our Megatropic satellite. That's a satellite from SRM University. Then almost a dozen universities are working. You can also join it as and when you are ready. ISRO can launch it free of cost. So, I talk about communications. There must be some definitions which EC students can note down also, because it's not there in the book. The communication word comes from a Latin word, communico, means share. Okay. And it is communication more than anything else which is responsible for the shrinking of time and distance. Now you may say, why time and distance? If you know, there are three books which, before I start, I think you should, each one should buy and read it. Okay, by Feynman, one of the authors is Feynman. One is Quantum Electrodynamics. Okay, that you should buy it. Another is Einstein's Cosmos. And the third book is In Search of Schrodinger's Cat. Okay. All three books, each student should buy, they are very costly. And if you read it, your mind will really get ignited. So communication is sharing, you know, that's a word comes. And nowadays, time and distance have lost their conventional meanings. You know, you simply send an email to somebody who may be on North Pole, South Pole, USA. You don't bother about the time. If the person is on the left, you reply back immediately. And you don't bother about the money also. Gone are the days, for every minute you have to pay 200 rupees for talking. Now, mobile services in many places are almost free in the country. Outside also they are not so costly. So you can talk. Email is almost free. So that's the impact and the popularity of the communication is there. We call the world today global village. You know, why do you call it global village? Because in village, whatsoever happens, I don't know whether somebody is from village or not, then one can be right. If suppose in one house, even if curry is cooked, everybody in the village will know what curry is cooked in that house. If suppose marriage is taking place, the whole village comes forward to welcome and celebrate the party and celebrate the marriage. That's the concept. So similar concept is there today in the world also. Suppose there is a cyclone in Florida or New Zealand or Philippines, okay, everybody knows about it. If there is a bomb blast or there is a riot in London, we are also worried, because somebody known to us, maybe our relative, may not be our relative, some known person may be involved in it, you know, that. So we are worried about it, we are concerned about it, not worried. Something happens in Afghanistan, you know, we may be concerned, one of our army person may be there. Or if not there, if you go slightly higher, you feel, well, such things are bad for a country which is just coming into the slums for war, etc. So you are concerned, and that concern has grown because of this communication only. And what is communication? You see, it's a response to a stimulus. You give a stimulus, you read a newspaper, you find out that, well, some blast has occurred or something has occurred in the USA or any place. If you know, you will try to find out, you go to net, you go to other places, you deal with TV. So that's the quickness of the response. And the quickness of the stimulus and the response is increasing in leaps and bounds. Now, there's another word, information. Okay? This definition you will not find in the textbook. It's related to communication means content of message. And grandfather Claude Shannon defined as information and reduction of uncertainty. And along with this information, there's another term which I did not put it, but it's called entropy. So there are many types of entropies. If you are an EC person, please try to read all those entropy definitions also. Entropy came from thermodynamics, came into statistics, came into communications also. So that's another thing. So information is a reduction of uncertainty. Information is also described any difference that makes a difference. Okay. See, it's an English language, but if you go into detail, you'll find out, yes, it is a pakka. I mean, it doesn't look like any difference that makes a difference. Doesn't mean anything. It means a lot. Okay. Information is a notch on the spectrum with raw data on low end, knowledge wisdom on the high end, and it suggests that the raw data when processed becomes information. Because similarly, when entropy increases, the randomness increases, the confusion increases, when you apply the estimation techniques, okay, take the best data out of it, apply the Kalman filtering, apply the optimization techniques, then you do it. And our ancestors used to have a lot of information, they would meditate over it. Their Kalman filtering was meditating, estimation techniques, and they came out with many things. So, these estimation techniques can be applied not only in electrical sciences, it can be applied anywhere else. So information minus knowledge is intelligence or understanding. Intelligence plus experience is knowledge, and knowledge when further processed through philosophic eyes becomes wisdom, and which is always respected, adored over ages. And the present day society is often termed as referred as information society. And now in the past, or life in last, let's say 15 years, the life has become unsettled. Earlier, if you would like to remain in a small village or a town or a district, taluk or a head, remain in the state, you would not like to go. Today, because of the means of communication, you don't mind going anywhere else. Your parents also don't mind. You can contact you in any way. And all these things have happened because of the TV, because of the telephony, and because of the internet and means of communication. So, it took centuries for the Middle Ages to become the Renaissance. Yet, many of us have experienced major technological revolutions in one's lifetime in last century. So, may not be the first or second year students, but the students who are around 16, 17 or 18 years, they have seen it. They have seen the growth of mobile. Okay. You have taken it for granted that things do come. But if you look into it, I suggest you should give a project to them. Find out in last 15 years what are the changes taken place in communications. What was the communication earlier, what is the communication now? You will find out. See, earlier, 3 years back, it was only the 2G. Okay. Now 3G is coming, 4G is coming, the future is getting changed. You did not even bother to think about it. What is 2G, what is 3G, what is 4G? What G stands for? Anybody knows? Yes. Okay. And it is in between there was 2.5G also. So many technological reversals have also taken place. Like the telephone, which was wired, now it is being wireless. You keep it in pocket. Okay. TV, which was wireless, now works on the cable. Cable TV. And it's a fact when we were, I was conducting interviews. So, for candidates for ISRO, so our BE student, we asked Surendra that how the TV is received. The idea was to ask them how TV antenna works. Then the smart young girl said, I received the TV through cable, so I cannot ask about Yagi antenna. I don't know how many of you know Yagi antenna, how many of you have seen Yagi antennas, but Yagi antenna was an antenna, 15-20 years back, was on everybody's house. And Bangalore, the TV came and it didn't become very popular, it used to come for a few hours only. So my son, who was very small, he said, Papa, if you don't buy TV, I just buy the antenna and put it. You are an antenna expert. Our individuals' fear of working has become almost universal. Like education, which you have come to the college, still you have come to college, but if you need not come, you cannot distance education sitting in your house. Banking, you have to go to bank. You don't have to go to bank. You do everything on your mobile now. It's possible. Okay? For medicines, if you maybe in a, you're sitting in Ladakh, northeast corner, if you need it, if there is a health worker, you can contact the specialist through the Teddy Medicine Kits and you get the all the treatment. So, I mean, you don't have to go to, for education purpose, you have to go to the university, you don't have to go. For doing the banking, you have to go to bank, you don't have to go now. So, all these things which were location specific factors have changed it. And there is a tremendous convergence, fusion of communications, computers and associated technology. So if you consider yourself, I am an IT specialist, IT generally loosely is considered as coding only, it is no longer valid. IT means communication, IT means computers, IT means collecting the information, and maximum thing in IT means mathematics. So those things are there. You know. Now, there are two buzzwords, one communication I give you, another is information technology. So, we are currently on the, third wave, okay, first was agriculture, then industrial revolution, now we are talking information and communication revolution, we are almost on the crest of that one. Now, there are communication tools, conventional ones, which are telephony, telegraph, radio, wireless, and not so conventional, they were not conventional 15 years back. See, one thing is that it's very difficult for any technological pundit to predict what's happening in the next 5 years. It's impossible. Beyond 5 years, you cannot predict. Things may change. See, I tell you, 5 years back, we were talking about IIT 2000 was there. I was in the UN, I was doing a workshop, IIT 2000. IIT 2000 did not take off. 3G started coming, 4G started coming. And I'm not sure what will be the next 3G, 4G. And again, in the commercial world, things change very fast. So, not so conventional is, emerged 1970 onwards, space communication, VSAT, electronic mail, audio, video conferencing, auto tracks, PCS, WLL, ISDN. And they become obsolete. Okay? For video conferencing, you are going to a small room. There were persons who were selling it. Now, how do you do video conferencing? Each one of you have got a laptop. For sure, he told me that. So you can do the video conferencing on Skype, correct? Free. It's available free. And you can do anywhere with mobile and the internet. Then, emerged last 15 years in mobile service, car, phone, telehealth, tele-education, multimedia system, okay, satellite navigation, digital TV, DTS, mobile, satellite communication, ultra broadband services, e-governance, e-commerce, e-banking, e-library, e-education, tele-education, anything you put e behind it except e-team. You can't do the e-team. So most important is, all these things lead to internet and World Wide Web. So the new trend is, major shift is from analog to digital, increase in value of software as compared to the hardware, extensive use of spread spectrum, use of optical technology, switches, LL, communications, etc. And all these things, total communication scenario is this one. Okay. So you have got everything, you have got television, cable TV, audio system, DVD, telephone, cellular, pager, etc. on one side. They come to the, get buzzed into one wide web, and these are IO devices. If you know anything else, please tell me, because it's a whole slide, I can add to it for the next lecture. And one wide web. So, you have come to that level, but if you want to go to distance, you have to take either the terrestrial route by optical communication or the microwave links, or go through the space. So, I will talk about the space thing. So, satellite communication, every day we manage to bounce radio waves at 36,000 kilometers, it comes back, okay? You see that your TV in the home, DTS, you don't have to need an operator. He comes and establishes the link in half an hour. So these artificial radio emitters are called communication satellites, and the communication satellites in the 70s were small in size, and the persons who could contact them, you have to book it from here, of course Neemrana, it was impossible to have a communication anywhere else. I have seen Neemrana because I used to pass through this place many times when I was going to Bangalore. It was a very small village, even I, when a very small village also I was here. So, But from Delhi, you book a train car, it will go to Bulandshahr, for building a railway station, inside the station, go to inside, then go to London, then go from there and all those things. Okay. Nobody ever came in direct contact with satellite. Today, through VSAT, through this TV, you are directly coming in contact with the satellite. The ground station antenna used to be 100 feet diameter. Today, the ground station antenna is in your pocket, I'll show you. So, situation changed considerably in 80s and communication requirements became really nerve-wracking. Imagine the transmission and reception of signal, a ship pitching and rolling on the high sea, an aeroplane flying at a speed of 800 kilometers, an orbiting spacecraft flying at the speed of 7 to 8 kilometers per second, an aeroplane or a ship in distress, a mountaineer, a tracker, a forest guard, an elephant, a tiger, a bird, a turtle, a dolphin. They all use communication satellites. A man always move a motor vehicle, and this, if you see the Discovery Channel, you know, besides the rock channel, you can see the Discovery Channel on National Geography, you will find all these things. How, you know, they put the radio collar, it directly comes to the satellite, and their movements, their health, everything is monitored. A man always will move a motor vehicle, he also has got a communication links. Both satellite talking, phone, or the GPS receiver. So if using satellite to communicate is a great marvel, doing without even stopping is still a great marvel. Now various conventional satellite communication services, you know it, telephony, TV broadcasting, weather monitoring, spacecraft, vehicle tracking, commanding, inter-satellite links, mail, internet, data mining, these are the conventional things. In last 10 years, positioning system and time determination has become very important. What is the accuracy of time you think you should have it? Anyone know, why? Otherwise you will start falling asleep, you know, you are taking a heavy breakfast. What is the accuracy you would like to imagine? Time accuracy. 1 second, 1 minute, 1 hour, picosecond, nanosecond. The timing accuracy needed now is nanoseconds, and GPS provides the nanosecond accuracy. Nanosecond is 1 in 10 to the power minus 9. So that's the accuracy we are looking for, 10 to 15 nanoseconds. That's the timing accuracy because, you know, your data rates have increased considerably. When you go into the optical domain, etc., you need a better timing accuracy. And all this communication satellite business, what is the business? It's around 20 billion in 1996, 75 billion it was in 2005, but projections came down from 66.5 to 66.5 because Iridium, which was an engineering marvel, failed on economic scales, but it's still being used. And in 2010, the projections were 100 million worldwide, and it touched to 120 billion. See, increasing in 20 billion is a huge amount. So that's the business. And current trends in worldwide satellite services in 2010 is there were 300 commercial satellites, 7,500 transponders, 1.2 million VSAT network, 125 million users, mobile satellite services 1.75 million users, and broadcasting was nearly 15 million users. And India, as of today, India is the only administration which controls maximum number of communication satellites and remote sensing satellites. And we have got almost, now it has become 187 transponders in the orbit. We need more than 500 transponders. We have to still go much ahead. And when I was involved with the InSat 1, which was we bought it from Ford Aerospace company, there were 12 transponders. And I heard the comments. I was a young person, I was asked to take the notes of the meeting. The Director General of DOD at the time, very senior person, told 12 transponders, what will you do with these transponders? Maybe TV person will use 2 or 3, we may use one or half a transponder, what will you do with the rest of the transponders? And today, we need more than 500 transponders, we have got a tremendous shortage of transponders. Worldwide, there is a shortage of transponders. The reason is the communication satellite provides you the last mile connectivity within hours. While if you want to establish a microwave link or bring the cables or anything, it takes much more time. The communication trends in 2020 will be broadband for all, access everywhere, future is mainly wired, fiber to home, it will be becoming affordable, convergence between wireless access. Why optical will come into picture? Because the electromagnetic spectra is already overcrowded. So there are two things which are, we cannot do anything in the day, you know. We can do miniaturization, we can increase the processing speed, but we cannot do anything. Even if you read it or read in the books or maybe internet also, that it was told some 10 years back that switching speed is limited by the electron transition, you know. Electron transition takes place. So you cannot increase the switching speed, this physical limit. But in between the transition also now they switch it. So even that physical limit also has gone. But the two things, one is electromagnetic spectra. There's nothing can be done. Okay, we are trying to reuse the spectra by, you know, polarizing diversity, by multiple beams. There are so many methods, by boundless techniques, but still you cannot do it. Another is, you cannot reduce the free space wavelength. So antenna sizes, you cannot reduce in the free. So, then convergence between wireless access, wireless mobile, wireless LAN, satellite links and fixed radio for access and remote, sparingly populated areas using low earth, middle earth geo systems, satellite links for security networks. So satellite will be used in inaccessible places where fiber cannot go. In large cities like Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, etc., fiber can do the job. But maybe a small village or suppose you are on the main trunk, so you can afford to have a fiber. But main places fiber doesn't go, LOS link doesn't go. In the inaccessible areas of Ladakh, etc., only satellite is there. And they have got a better means of communication. I was there last year. They have got better means of communication. Mobile works, they are better than what it works in Neemrana. So, before one goes ahead with communication satellites, it will be quite important and relevant to talk about the latest arrival of the communication technology, internet and the web. And it's a new incarnation of mass communication, cheapest, it's almost free. And it's the parasite, which has almost eaten away the post, the telecom channels. So, have you seen any parasite? Hey, students, come on, have you seen any parasite?
Yes, sir.
Where? Give an example. See, if you see in the garden or many places, you know, in some trees, there is a thread-like thing, it's called amarbale. It's that's the parasite that eats away the tree itself. There's a yellow color thread-like thing, that's the parasite, it eats away the, whole tree itself. Maybe tree of any size. So, internet, which runs on the optical, your communication links, telephone links, it has eaten away. Nobody uses the telephone for that purpose. All the transfers of data, information is going through the internet. When you go for e-governance, everything is through the internet only. So, it's a parasite which has eaten the host and is influencing our sphere of life every day. Internet, which we know as today, has come to Asia in 2000, and in India also it has come lately only, will play an important role at least till 2015, the present internet I am talking about, not beyond that, 2015 is very near to it. The internet provides a vast array of services, acts like a multimedia system, information resources, ways to perform work and engage in commerce. It has an estimated 600 million users, which gets doubled every year. The safest prediction is that by 2015, the internet as we know, it will no longer exist after 2015. There will be just be the net, a ubiquitous broadband data dial tone provider by a cable telephone operator, wireless operator or the satellite operator. So, and it has happened in way, if you got a blueberry, you know, you can, blackberry or black, you get all the information in that one. It's a way, it's a powerful computer in your hand. So, what is the impact of the economist is a very conservative UK magazine, and he said that impact of internet, it will be ahead of telephone and television, which we see had a larger impact, but it will be behind the printing press and the motor car. The reason is, before printing press, there was no means of communication or mass spreading of the information. Person used to write and do it. But once communication, so you know, something by zero becomes infinity by mathematically. So that has an infinite impact. But internet has got almost a similar type of impact. You even don't realize. So take this action item, do a project work. What is the impact of internet and the present day mobile communication services have got? The point is that net is a phenomenon that cannot be ignored. Many parents don't want to have internet in the house because they say all forbidden sites the children will see. But they are forgetting that children will learn many things. They can put a firewall, they can do anything. But you see, sometimes the forbidden sites also they should see, otherwise how will they know about it? So it is an agent of change in all sectors of society. So change won't occur in isolation but will going on simultaneously. Everyday changes are coming, resulting in unpredictable, unanticipated synergy, and in turn this will lead to truly profound change in society. And to help all these things, to take it to inaccessible places, the communication has to play an important role, and the satellite communication plays an important role. The largest cities will be taken care by optical links, which can handle terabytes of data, and inaccessible place by satellite communication. So this is the scenario of communication. You know, they are in robotics. Professor Manke is here. I understand he is a controls man. In robotics and controls, you have got 6 degrees of freedom. In communication, the degrees of freedom depends on your thinking, what you can think about it. So this is the scenario where a personal mobile communication should be there. You could be in air, you could be in a vehicle, home. You can be in transit, you can be in the office, you can be in the market, you can be in the sea, anywhere you would like to communicate. And persons when they go, except in the hotels, even in the bathroom, there is a receiver, telephone receiver. So that's the importance of communication. If you may miss anything, you may miss your breakfast, but you will always carry your mobile. That you will not miss. Even if in the aircraft, they say you switch off, or you go into the security agency, you switch it off, you put in meeting mode, put in your pocket, camouflage it and go. That is so important. You will not do the same thing with your food, you will not do the same thing for anything. But for mobile, you will do anything, you will try to cheat the person, security agency. And what has happened in communications? I told you the ground stations which are becoming smaller and smaller, day by day, are coming to the pocket size. See, in the 70s, this is the size. Satellites were like, you know, early bird had only 248 channels. 248 communication channels, okay? Today the satellites have got thousands of channels. Even insect has got thousands of channels. Satellites were 250 kilograms. Today satellites are going 5 to 6 tons. The biggest satellite which was launched, it was a low Earth orbiting satellite for climate check. The weight was 39 tons and it was being assembled at Guru before launching. I also went to Guru at that time and we went to see the climate set. I was shocked that one person was walking on the satellite. Okay. So, I mean, because the 39 ton satellite, how do you assemble it if you don't walk? If you don't use the crane. So the climate set is working wonderfully well. So ground system was 100 feet, slowly satellite sizes went on increasing, the satellites we got almost 5 to 8 tons and the ground system antenna has come to the pocket of the smart ready. That is satellite communication telephones are of pocket size things. That's the revolution which has taken place in the thing. Now in the foreseeable future, with new equipment techniques will be used in satellite technology which will extend and improve the possibility of satellite communication beyond present day imagination. The size of the geo satellites will go on increasing. There will be small satellites also for a small capacity. There will be a dynamic power sharing. Antenna beam width will be configured. The spectrum will be reused. Multiple beams will be created. Not will be. They are being created. Turai is one satellite which does all these things. We will have efficient signal processors, switching equipments, which will enable signal processing to perform onboard write down to the operations similar to the switching exchange, which will provide better mesh connectivity. Network technology for the seamless integration of high data rates, communications, satellites and terrestrial facility. Direct connection between the satellite will shorten the transmission route, inter-satellite links, which will operate in the optical band also, V band or optical band, because V band, car band doesn't get affected by rains. There are no rains there. It gets affected on the earth by rains. And optical links also, there is no interference, will be there. The inter-satellite links will be in millimeter waves, optical waves. And the use of higher frequency bands like car and V band and frequency used by multiple beams will enlarge the available bandwidth and thus the transmission capacity, and future even space laser communication is also anticipated. It has got some problems also. The miniaturization of electronics will enhance the launch capability and reduce the cost. You know, when we were students, we means including some of your faculty members also, we were told that if you are going into the VHF range, your circuits will be very bulky. If you have microwave, you have to go in waveguides only. Use tunnel diodes, use tubes and stuff. Today, the miniaturization has become independent of the frequency. The size, whether you are opening in VHF or you are opening in microwave band or car band or KV band, the size of the circuit and complexity remains almost same. So you will see the waveguides only in your books. So that's the impact of this thing. So high speed two-way internet through VSAT, this will avoid an installation of broadband access through terrestrial network. It can provide up to 40 megabits of data. Last mile connection can be there, you don't have to run the lines. The new build of satellites will be agile, flexible, intelligent, powerful. They will have digital bandwidth. This makes the services they carry an easy fitting to present their digital network with a specific provided ground equipment. And why I talk about digital? Digital bandwidth, you know, in one bit, how many bits you can put inside? That's called digital bandwidth. Everything is digital. You can go into software mode, you know, software defined radios, anything you can do it. So today, the world is changing from analog to digital. I'm not sure, maybe after 10, 15 years, analog will come back again. Because when you've got analog signal processing, etc., you don't lose the information. And in digital, you come to the digital domain, you lose the information. And today we say that this much information in quantization, I can always lose it, I can afford to lose it, but maybe there will be a situation where you don't want to do it. So continuously change the antenna beam patterns, EIRP traffic demand, buffer and multiplex data, null interference providing a strong clear signal, cross-link to other satellites. The future satellite will be small geo for co-located at a single point. In India, we were the first country to co-locate because, you know, real estate at 36,000 kilometers is very costly. So we have co-located the 3-4 satellites together at one point. We have really mastered that technique. Large geo satellites will be suitable and will establish in KU band, car band, and they can have many things like InSat has got broadcasting, telecommunications, data transmission, and map monitoring, etc. So everything can be in one satellite. We will have mini, micro, mono and pico satellites for communication purposes. The satellite driven broadband system will become more popular because it provides the last mile solution which is greater boon for developing countries. Now satellite has got innate advantage. You know, you decide today that you should have a satellite. It takes maximum 24 months to realize the satellite, launch it, make it operational. And the last mile connection, you bring the satellite dish antenna, VHF terminal, put it in your house, it takes less than half an hour. You telephone to your dish TV person, he comes, he takes less than half an hour to establish. And he has got a very, you know, my house he came to establish, I was watching very keenly. He doesn't know anything about polarization, etc. Nothing he knows. He comes, establishes, he has got an angle, for instance, Bangalore, this angle he has to pick it. He fits it and then he does some small adjustment and he has got a small meter. That meter is also good. I mean, if I was asked to design, I would have used the spectrum analyzer, this cost 50 lakhs. He has got the meter which must not be costing more than 15,000 rupees, which he usually put it, maximize the signal, answer up the signal. That's the thing. He need not know what satellite consists of. He's the person who can do it. He comes. If there is a problem, he comes and settles again by the same means. It takes less than half an hour to produce the last mile connection. So, and now you see why optical fiber? You know, all the roads are dug. we get become inconvenient. I mean, inconvenience is caused to us by the fiber, but fiber can take terabytes of data. The broadband satellites are constructed with poor quality of optical fiber communication. No country requires more than one satellite can provide. Europe requires 450 megabits of data per second. US bound capacity 3.5 gigabits per second. Rest of the world is around 2.5. A satellite can provide much more than this. Many times one feels that over capacity of the fiber, because you have got a fiber link. Since link has come to your institution or house, you have to pay for it. But for satellite, you pay the time you are using it. So these are the transponder usage in 2000, ISP 9%, video feeds were 7%, telephone was 43%, broadcasting was 41% in 2000. In 2010, multicasting became 13%, direct access, which was not there, became 29%. ISP 9 to 17%, video feeds 4%, telephony, which was 43%, became 9%. Because all these things have been taken care by the mobile and also by the optical links. So in my opinion, future space communication scenario will be InfoSat. The future telecommunications spacecraft will be developed from transmission into information satellite. They will be given many of the properties of the terrestrial telephone exchanges, signal processing equipment, and it will be possible to integrate them directly into the future global network. They will thus permit immediate application of many existing and future services. It will like act a communication laboratory in space. It will also have sensors which will monitor the environment, and it will be autonomous. Everything, you know, I mean, if there is a failure, it will try to rectify it and so on. It will have a redundancy in all those things. And satellites, besides autonomous control, power generation equipment, will have sensors to provide monitor Earth's atmosphere. Any industry is polluting the environment, it will immediately report. Now also, if industry pollutes the environment, you complain, the inspector comes. The management takes him inside, gives him nice food and some packet, and he goes back, there's a, our pollution is within the limits. But the satellite will not, can't drive. They will monitor the cyclone, they will be used for disaster mitigation, disaster monitoring, okay, and disaster management. So this is the scenario in the future, it will be there. You will have a, international satellites, there will be a national satellites, there will be low Earth orbiting satellites, and there will be a ground network. Everything will get connected to each other. Okay? And it will be seamless information exchange. And you can be anywhere, you can be in personal computer, you can be in the state, you can be in the air, you can be anywhere. You will get all the information. So this is the future scenario in InfoSat, which is already taking place, and in the next 5 years you will find there is no boundary between satellite communication, the terrestrial communication, or the mobile communication. It will all get available, and it will be InfoSat, information satellite. So Indian scenario is, we have got a major role in broadcasting, business, communication, using VSAT communication for social applications, or founding father Vikram Sarabhai, imagine that space technology should be used by for the common man. In 1969, in America, the ISRO satellite was being planned. And he said, they had an experiment to do the career education, satellite education. And he said, India will be the laboratory for it. Satellite was shifted in 75. For 1 year, we had called satellite instructional television experiment. And 1969, we did not have TV in the country. We had no technology. Still, he had guts to tell, oh, we'll develop our own things. And yes, some of the antennas you may see here still on the way. Large chicken mesh antennas were there. And the experiment was done for 1 year. It was very successful. So India was the first country to use the satellite for education purposes. Advanced satellite bus, we have developed ground system technology for large improvements in performance and reliability and cost. Extensive R&D base in the country, through participation of industry and academic institutions. We are transforming the India into vibrant satellite communication. Not only we make satellites, we made almost 60 satellites. Not only we make satellites for ourselves, we made satellites for Europe. We are supplying components to USA. Our remote sensing satellites, India has got the largest constellation of remote sensing satellites. which every country uses except Pakistan. We have got resolutions of Pangolin satellites around a meter, less than a meter. We are going to launch, you know, radar imaging satellite. Already one satellite is working, another radar imaging satellite. And all these designs have been done in the country. Again, I am repeating what I said, it has been done by normal engineering college students. None of them were trained in California. We have got satellites, almost 15 satellites in the orbit. Now we have GSA up to GSA 12, GSA 8 are also into the orbit. We have got one satellite only for monitoring the weather. You can see the cyclone picture, etc. You know, if you see Doordarshan, they say, oh, upgraha ke dwara, that is from the Kalpana one. It has MedSat, which was Christian as a Kalpana, after Kalpana Chawla by Prime Minister Vajpayee at that time. So, we have got, the number of filing, there are issues with communication satellites. In K-band itself is increased considerably. And satellites are coming, earlier it was 2 degree separation, now we have come to 1.5 degree separation. Now it has come to that you can co-locate the spacecraft. So interference from each other, the probability that it should not collide, the station keeping, the monitoring of the spacecraft, all this is very important.
What is the y-axis here, not very
clear? This is the number of administrations which have filed that thing. Like, you know, countries which have filed, almost every country has filed, including a country, a small country like Tongo. They also filed for 3 satellites. Because they can, those costs they are allotted to, they can hire, give to somebody else. Like, you know, somebody buys N number of flats, so you can give on rent. Almost similar thing is being done by many countries. So, issues with communities is privacy. You can always do the dropping. That's very impossible. Check on use of terrorist and anti-social activities. We have got no control on that one. They can spoil our satellites also. We don't know what is the impact on environment and biosphere, EMI, EMC, health hazards. Some persons feel, this house sparrow, which was very common, has died down. And some persons feel it is because of the mobile towers, it has died down. Because its egg is so small, whatsoever energy comes, it reduces the size, egg shell thickness. Maybe inside egg itself it gets destroyed. So these are some of the things we don't know. Health hazards, electronic waste is the biggest challenge today. All those the thermopole things you will find on the site, you cannot even destroy it. They are not biodegradable. Interoperability of all communication systems, compatibility of various services, that's also a problem because standards are different. Intellectual property rights, the biggest issue. Manufacturing of devices and participation in services by Indian industry in the global communication paradigm, not many industries are coming forward. Besides the communication satellite, so I told you we have got the largest constellation. We have got the satellites which are almost one ton. The GSAT is almost now in the orbit, is around 1 ton. It's got life for around 11 years. 2 satellites, other inside satellites, like GSAT 8, which has got life of 15 to 16 years, and they got the number of transponders, the weight is around 4 to 5 tons. So another thing which we have taken is Global Navigation Satellite System, GNSS. Each one you've heard the GPS. Okay. Your mobile handset also gives you a position, but it is not directly linked with the GPS. With respect to towers, it gives the position, but maybe some handsets are available which directly get connected to the GPS also. India, GPS does not provide you very accurate, and they are still reliable information. If you get the information, they are transmitting free information, but because you use it at your own risk. Like when you do the parking at many parking places, at owner's own risk, park at owner's own risk. So you can use it, you don't know the reliability of the signal, GPS signal. Satellite may be working, may not be working. To provide all these things, a reliable system, the GPS has to be augmented. And we are augmenting the GPS system, the global navigation satellite system, by a system called Gagan. So, navigation is a process of determining one's position, velocity, including time, and time accuracy is order of 10 to 15 nanoseconds. These solutions together are called state vectors and of the observer, and the state vectors can be found out very accurately. The accuracy could be in centimeters. For some information, accuracies are of the order of millimeter waves, millimeters. And you know millimeter means if I see it's like this is 1 centimeter, so it should be less than that. Otherwise, I understand in centimeters. Actually, once I was asking some students, you know, that 10 centimeter, how big is a 10 centimeter? It came from this size to this size. So, Indian scenario is we are providing satellite positioning system, IRS scientific satellites and for Gagan. We put our own GPS receivers on the, you know, satellites, and we don't do the tracking from there. The satellite gives its own position. We are participating in Galileo and GLONASS. We have planned our own regional navigation satellite system construction. Ionosphere and tropospheric studies we have done it, because India is on the magnetic equator. Okay. And we have got that, you know, that if some physics person is there, he will know about it. We have got electron jets and gradients, very high gradients, starting from Ahmedabad to Calcutta. In that region, maximum ionospheric disturbances take place. There are ionospheric bubbles are there. And ionosphere in positioning creates maximum error from ionosphere.
What is
the
magnetic equator and geographic equator?
Magnetic equator is passing through Trivandrum. There is a difference of almost 10 to 11 degrees. So this is the Gagan system, GPS aided geo augmented navigation system. It aids the GPS. This is the coverage of Gagan. We have got a master control center at Bangalore, and also another master control center we are establishing at Delhi. It's being taken with the help of Airport Authority of India. The Gagan signal will be available in October onwards. We have put the GSAT 8 transponder. We will put another satellite GSAT 10, which will have the GPS transponder. And advantage of this one is the aircrafts, which, you know, in the unmanned places, like small airstrips, we have got 408 airstrips in the country. So, and they only 8 airports are equipped with all the facilities. Rest are all equipped. So, once the Gagan becomes operational, the aircraft can land very easily. The heli services also will be. What happened to the Arunachal Chief Minister? Or Rajshekhar Reddy could have been avoided if Gagan was operational at that time. The concept of satellite-based augmentation is that, these are GPS satellites, their informations are taken, they are collected by the reference, there are a lot of reference stations are there, almost 15 reference stations around the country. They collected, find it out whether some satellite is working or not. We apply the ionospheric, tropospheric corrections to it, send that all those signals to a geostationary satellite, and from there the information comes to the user. It could be aircraft, it could be anybody user. So we are applying the ionospheric corrections. Ionosphere provides errors of the order of even 20 meters. We apply the ionospheric correction, we apply the satellite correction, we apply the clock correction. Because everything is ranging in this world, you know. So if the clock, like 1 nanosecond is 30 centimeters. So if you are 1 second error in time or even nanoseconds, you are quite away from your targeted destinations. So you have to have a timing correction. You should know the position of the GPS satellites also very accurately. Okay. So all those things are pointed to ground station, and then it will help the aircraft to land it. And this satellite-based augmentation is called Gagan. USA has got VAS, Wide Area Augmentation System. Europe has got IGNOS, European Geo Overlay Navigation System. Japan has MSAS, and India has Gagan. So there will be a seamless navigation along aircraft without any control. And now aircraft flies, you know, suppose the aircraft flies from Bangalore, okay, and it needs to go to, say, Dubai. You know, how does it go? It will come from, start from Bangalore, go to Belgaum, go nearby Bombay, then go near to Karachi, and then take turn to Bangalore, then go to Dubai side. So it can, once Gagan becomes operational, it can directly go. So traffic congestion gets reduced, fuel gets reduced, fuel cost gets reduced, and time also gets reduced. That will always happen with Gagan. So this is what we are doing. We got the GPS L1, L2 and L5 frequency from all the GPS. We collect from the reference stations, 15 reference stations around the country. And reference stations, not only we have got the redundancy, we have got triple redundancy, because you cannot afford, all the reliability has to be 5 lines. You cannot afford, because you know, critical safety of critical, safety of life is involved in this one. And availability of this total system is 1 in 10 to the minus 9. This works out to be that you can have one accident in 37 years. Only by simulation, we cannot measure these things. That sort of reliability is needed. Then we have got a ground segment, all the actual center information. We collect it, we make a message format, which is GPS-like format, transmit to the geo-satellite, and that will be going to the user. User receiver, without knowing it, will apply all the corrections. These are, we had a technical demonstration phase. What you see red, it very places, you know, like this is for Guwahati. So blue one, or purple one is the thing which you have the governor results, and red one is the GPS alone results. See, with the GPS or any receiving system, you don't get a point accuracy. The reason is because of ionosphere, because of uncertainty, there is always a dispersion on 24 hours. So the governor we get an accuracy of the order of 1 to 2 meters, while GPS in standalone accuracy is around the order of 20 meters. I mean, it can improve. And 1 to 2 meters is assured accuracy. So, this is the position of magnetic equator, it passes through Surendra. And, our next country which is equally advanced as India is Brazil. So they have done a lot of studies, but here gradients are different. So, we have to do a lot of studies for the ionosphere. And India has developed, as my team has developed, a dual model set for ionosphere. And that has been accepted by Raytheon, who's our contractor for ground segment by Americans also. And this is a contribution to GNSS scenario from India. Another, we have got Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System. It consists of presently 7 power satellites. The 3 satellites are 34, 33 and 132, the geostationary satellite, and other satellites are the geosynchronous satellites, highly 29-degree inclination. We are going to put 4 more satellites. So then, we presently our mandate is geopolitical boundary of India plus 1500 kilometers. It should provide accuracy better than GPS. Now, our security agency, mainly it's for them, because GPS is controlled by Department of Defense of US.
Can you explain what those finger of feet?
They are not geostationary, they are geosynchronous. Height is 37 degrees. 36,000 kilometers, but we are given inclination to 29 degrees. See, geostationary satellite has got almost 0 degree inclination. It's almost to the point. 0 degree is not possible, but almost near to 0 degree. Well, this has got 29 degree inclination. So, one satellite goes south, another will go to north. Okay? And they are phased in such a manner. See, there is something called the dilution of precision, geometrical dilution of precision. So, if the satellites are widely apart, you get a better accuracy than the satellites together. So, there are 3 satellites are stationary. The 4 satellites are not stationary, they are geosynchronous. They are widely apart. So, that provides the minimum dock.
And that is the mechanism for co-locating the satellite?
No, co-locating is a different thing. Co-locating means each satellite is controlled, its inclination is controlled better than 0.01 degree. So they are together. We don't allow that this sort of thing to build up. See, this requires north to south station keeping. We don't allow this to go up. So this is only purposefully done. And 4 more satellites will put that it will have a reach up to Mongolia and site Iraq. And then finally it will go to.
When we launch satellites, how do you decide whether it should be a LEO, MEO, or a GEO orbit? What are the pros and cons?
Initially itself. So we plan it, we give the, velocity and the vertical inclination. So orbital velocity is planned in that way. But if it's a LEO, it's around 7 kilometers per second. Mm-hmm. When you put GEO, around less than 3 kilometers per second.
No, but when do you send them to LEO, when to GEO?
See, it's a planning itself, you know, like all scientific satellites are low Earth orbit. All communication satellites are geostationary orbit. they are planned in the beginning stage itself at the part of the purpose of the satellite. And what satellites, small satellites are launched for the students is, I mean, their orbit remains with the host satellite orbit. They don't have a choice. So this is the coverage of, this white coverage is the coverage of 99.5% of the time of the ISRO coverage. And this we have got vertical alert limit, horizontal alert limit. So these are the things which we should go about. So current GNSS applications are personal navigation, mobile, PDA, automatic applications, signal navigations, maritime applications, inside the room, etc., how to improve the location. Now GPS doesn't work inside the room, but GPS assisted services would work even in tunnel, etc. So these are the assisted GNSS applications. If you, anybody wants to do a research, this is a very good area of doing research, where you take all the positioning systems, all communication systems, combine it together, and that become associated GNSS global navigation satellite systems. What are the areas of research in GNSS is aerotropo modeling in the equatorial region. Okay, you can do radio occultation for the weather monitoring. Technology-wise precision orbit determination, time synchronization, development of navigation software, atomic clocks, rubidium, cesium clock, isoflux antenna development, these are some of the things. And issues related with GNSS are interoperability, because GPS has got a separate thing, GLONASS has got a separate modulation schemes and formats, GLU has got a separate scheme also. So all interoperability becomes one issue. The same receiver cannot use unless you make a receiver which receives all the constellations. It's a big issue. Then multi-power, indoor, urban environment, interferences. Need for higher energy jamming margins. The signal which we receive is of order of minus 160 dBW of GPS signal. It's a very weak signal. It can be interfered by anybody's thing. So, ionospheric solar weather impact on GNSS signals. Solar flares, the sunspot activity interferes with the GNSS maximum. Universal time reference, time synchronization. So for all these things, we have established a timing center in Bangalore, which will provide, ISRO's timing center will provide better than 10 nanoseconds accuracy using cesium blocks and hydrogen measure. Hydrogen has got a stability of 1 inch 10 to the power minus 15. That sort of stability is it has got. So conclusion is, communication is of prime importance next to food for the mankind and for modern day communication paradigm. Space communication provides fast-paced and last-mile connectivity to anyone, anywhere. After all, we need our measurements of time, space also. And for the emerging civil aviation scenario, less than 5 years, every aircraft, not aircraft, every train, every road, bus, every taxi will have a governed receiver, because it will provide you its own space. Not only this, devices can be developed for anti-collision, etc. So you don't have to have radars for this one. And amalgamation of communication navigation in the future, it's called NavCom. That's another area of research for the university. Hence, NavCom means communication with GNSS will influence our life more than any other technological advent. And, quickly in 5 minutes, because morning we had discussion, so I'll tell you a small satellite thing. This time is there for 10 minutes? See, small satellite, you know, when you have a discussion at breakfast, maybe your university can start making a small satellite, a nano satellite. So this is the classification of the satellite. See, small satellites are called up to 690 kg of satellites, are called small satellites. Up to 100 kg of satellites are called micro satellites. then less than 10 kg satellites are called nano satellites, and 1 kg satellite is called pico satellites, and then less than 1 kg is called femto satellite. See? You can make a satellite which is a pico satellite 1 kg. That satellite needs, it has got almost 1 kg satellite has got almost everything now. You can put a processor, you put a solar panels, you put a DC-DC converter, you put a small battery, and total weight should be around 1 kg. And it's possible to do it because your handset mobile, okay, which is less than 250 grams, has got everything in it. It has got a power supply, it has got a DC-DC converter, it gets charged also, and it has a computer. Even this can become a small satellite, except that if you have a thermal control, it should withstand the mechanical vibrations, and it should, So, see, this is a concept is that you can have a ground station. You can operate in VHF or small IR can create it. And you have to have a beacon on the satellite, which will tell you, yes, I am alive. And beacon can be modulated to the TTC network also. This is the total thing which a small satellite produces. You got a small satellite in the orbit, there is an ionosphere environment, you got ground station and beacon can tell, I am alive.
What's the frequency of the beacon?
You can put it in S band or VHF, but for a university it's better to put in VHF because ground station establishing is very easy.
What's the periodicity? How frequent do you?
Well, if you put in, it will be put mostly along with the PSLV, so around 98 minutes is the orbital time. So it can appear on you for 4 to 5 times in a day. So, you have to need to know the orientation, so you put magnetometer and sun sensors, you can develop your own sun sensors, you can make your own magnetometers. Need to maintain orientation, you can apply the controls, law, magneto torques, small magneto torques, manufacture yourself, put it. Very small ones, you know, miniature, as the magneto torques. You can have onboard processing, put the FPGA or any small processor. You don't have to go for microcontrollers. And you put a small beacon of less than half a watt, you will know that it's alive. So, you need to have a power, and power solar cells, they are costly, but one can get it always from ISRO. Lithium ion batteries, which you use it day in, day out for your camera or for many things, you can use the same thing. Go for commercial components, test it, and make a satellite. These are the communication satellite is typical UGNM or VHF satellites. The ground station can be there in the array, etc. A small ground station in this country, the LNA transfer, etc. You can make your own systems. And advantage is low mass, low power, low volume, less components, more reliability, lower cost per satellite, quick realization. I mean, if you start, you are in the second year, you start working on that one. By the time in final year, you will always get, you make the satellite, you can have the slot. And when should you make the satellite? Not in the steady time. Make it in the nights. In place of seeing TV or gossiping, you gossip while making the satellite itself. These are some of the LEO constellations. The small satellite, pretty small satellites are there. Micro satellite clusters can be created. So many things are there, the formation flying. The nano satellites, you know, NASA has put a shell into the orbit to find out what is the impact of solar radiation. Solar radiation also has got a, what do you call it, pressure on it. The small satellites can be on chip also. You can have RF components, you can have CMOS, less than 10 CMOS, CMOS computing less than 10 grams. You can have the total thing, solar systems. So you can always look for a satellite on chip. Small satellites, you know, which universities can make it. So, the small satellites have started from bigger to satellite on a chip, the large satellite. These are all conventional things which persons are following, but you are very young, your university is young, try for this. You can have the small propulsions also, micro propulsions, on that one. You can have the small power cars. The wheels are of this size, means which are used in, you know, robots. Many industries are making it, they can give you. See, these are the large satellites, you know.
Yes.
Okay. But small satellites can be handled by a single person. This is why IMS-1, which are first satellite, which give a small satellite, which give the pictures also. You can take a small camera and take pictures. This is the huge satellite, which was made by India, but experimented by Russian University. See, in the PSLV, this is one satellite is there, small satellite, nano satellite, pico satellite. Then this is another satellite is here, another satellite is here. So one by one the satellites will be released into the orbit. This is a HAMSAT, which was made a small satellite by ISRO, by actual amateur HAMSAT operators. So already four small satellites made by other than ISRO have been into orbit. So this is the way satellites are put. One satellite is here, another this is Norwegian satellite, not Norwegian, Argentinian satellite. There is an EKG. Another satellite is here.
Another satellite is here. They are attached to the main satellite.
No, attached to the launcher. Main satellite is this one.
They are like spring loading?
There is a mechanism which operates on a spring. Okay. So it provides the initial velocity. So one by one they were sequenced and then they launched it. So there were, at one time we launched 10 satellites together. This two set was one satellite, which was mass was less than 1 kg. It was 100 by 100 by 100 mm cube and carried a panchromatic camera, 3 axis stabilization magnetometer, magnetic torque, power was 2 watts, life was 1 year, still is working. This is a Pratham satellite, nano satellite by IIT Bombay. It is not launched, they are making this the IIT Kanpur, because IIT Kanpur is slightly, you know, ahead on technology. So they are also making it. This is a Jugnu satellite by IIT Kanpur, another student satellite. SRM satellite and nano satellite, this will be launched next month. This is a Satyabhama University satellite. So it could be satellites, small satellites for many applications. This is one system which is a patented system. You put a satellite inside it and it releases. It's called a poly pico satellite orbit deployer. So I also give you a small presentation of the small satellites. I thank you for listening, and I also thank Professor Rajesh Shore to give me an opportunity to see this beautiful campus. I was impressed by the campus, and I'm sure this university will grow much bigger, and they'll make satellites, they'll make many things. It's only the innovative thinking which you can do it, and things will follow automatically.